this occurs around the abdomen. This also is from the different texts as different journals. These are not my views. Don't say that I am putting this issue. Only thing is I have collected the information and sharing the information. Comparatively, the body size and the appearance of an Indian tail and a Western tail. Of course, that photograph shows you the difference. There could be whether you like that body or that's another issue. You may consider one side of the body the other way or the other way. Basically, an Indian tail or Indian feature would be of a relatively shorter stature, underweight, whereas the Western culture would be a chubby babies. And of course, unfortunately, again, if you look at all the photographs of the winning prizes for children now, you have Children's Day, next day you will have the photographs of the children in paper. I always see all that overweight obese children are here. And so you can count how many of them will be diabetic. So, that's the basic issue. And now it is on us to create such an awareness among the society. Unfortunately, Indian Council of Medical Research doesn't have this view. That's the unfortunate thing. All our Western doctors, they are just following the famine theory, and they say that we had a famine and now we have that scarcity of the food and you have to have supplements. Everyone will be prescribing with a vitamin supplement and something like a growth supporting issues and so on. They are not really needed. All that what we need to have is go back to the basic tradition which is needed for India. Or our genes. Our genes are not meant for that kind of the culture. That's all the point. Now, comparatively, that black color in the other graph, the black color suggests about the average, the total linear body mass, whereas the fat would be the round one. Now, because the whole linear body mass is lesser in India, among the Indian races, naturally, whenever there is even a small amount of fat accumulated, that produces an appearance of that sort, where the belly, abdomen and the back would become bulged. And that's exactly the reason, that's exactly a quality which is attributed to the gene. It is, who is responsible for that? It's the gene which we have the responsibility. And that gene is, now it's named as a Harappan genome and a Harappan gene. So, name as such is different. Next. Same issue. Again, the same pattern. Now, when you have this kind of a thin fat phenotype, you may have a better tolerance to that fat accumulation. Whereas a thick fat phenotype, you have a lesser tolerance to that accumulation of the fat. So even if a slightly fat is increased amongst the Indian population, that results in diabetes much earlier than the Western. So we are more prone to diabetes because our body stature or structure is not meant for that kind of accumulation of the fat. Now the same issue, the risk of diabetes mellitus is now identified with the risk of low birth weight. Those who have a low birth weight, they are having a higher risk of diabetes mellitus. Again, it's not a primary risk of diabetes mellitus. Whenever there is a cumulative factors, precipitating factors, those precipitating factors result in a early incidence of the diabetes and a higher percentage of incidence of the diabetes. This also is from the same data publications, again not mine. When the low birth weight, when there are relatively lesser risk factors, the other graph that is the accumulation, that vertical axis of the graph shows you the risk factors, whereas horizontal is about the birth weight. Lower the birth weight, and even if there is a lesser incidence of the risk factors, the diabetes would be pronounced. Whereas higher the birth weight, they have a better tolerance. So that's the point. And genetically, we are meant to have lesser birth weight as such. So that's also the point as such. Next. Now, in this situation, all that theory about the famine gene and so on, I say that's a myth. Indian culture and Indian tradition about the food, perception of the food, is we had that tradition of plenty. Rather, and that's why you had that Western invasion. All the Western country people had come over here because they had idea that you could get the food or some benefit here. Not that they have come to a famine country. Of course, we had some famine. Our medical council, Indian Council of Medical Research says that in Bengal, there was a famine for 5 years, 1857, and after that, the famine genes have started. genes do not get changed in 5 years. For the genes to get mutated, you need many generations together. And these genes were there 5,000 years earlier. That's what I said. The newspaper report which says that that kind of a gene existed 5,000 years earlier. And that whole theory of Aryan invasion and cultivation or farming from that area is now being excluded. Whereas our scientists say that we had that Pemain gene and we are in the scarcity area, so we need to provide more nourishment. That's how the whole issue is presented now as such. And our culture is not to live for eating. Instead, we are of the culture where eat to live. And very interestingly, that Annapurna, I think it is no one with that name, goddess who is supposed to be the goddess of the food, prayer to the goddess is Jnana Vairagya Siddhyartham, Ekshamdehi. The urge for food, your need for the food is achieve the Jnana and Vairagya, not for the other. So that's the basic theme, and that's what we have lost. And it looks odd, and it becomes a subject of joke when I say that. Our mythology, Upanishad, it says, Brahma Arpanam, Brahma Havihi, Brahma Arno, Brahma Nahutam, Brahma Yuma Tena Gantavyam, Brahma Karma Samajana. The whole consumption of the food and that digestion is a Brahma Karma. That's a Yajna. It's not for yourself. It's a universal activity which you have to maintain. And so whole idea of the food consumption is for maintenance of the life. And the rule is, whenever you have a food, you have to share with others. Atithi Satkara has to be done. And only after you have supplied the food to the others, you have to eat as such. In the Shraddha Karma, now those who do the Shraddha, Purohitas do that utter that mantra. So Anna Sheshehi Kum Priyata, Istei Saha Bhinjata. I think those who have that acquaintance with that, the Istei Saha Bhojana, the food you have to consume with your family, would be only the Anna Shesha. Not that you do not have the food. Now that's the important. It's not because you have the famine. You have to supply or provide the food to the others, and whatever is left over is the food on which you have to depend on. Istei Saha Bhojana, that all that get together, is not to show your richness, or it's not a party. It's the other way. Only after providing these to the society and the needy, only this has to be consumed. So having party, luxury, get together, that's not the real Indian culture as such, which we are now accustomed to. And every incident is a sufficient reason for us to have food. Even after the lecture, you have a high tea. That's the basic issue. So primarily, the basic issue about why the diabetes is increasing is we are not living as our genes are dictating. And we say that our genes are poor genes and then we need to have a support. That's not the reality. The reality is we need to live as the genes are dictated. And our identity is about the intellectual capacity, not the physical energy. That's the basic issue. And if we follow that, I am sure the incidence of the diabetes would be reduced. I think accidentally in the last session, there was one of the reference I said about, I have a very strong diabetic gene, but I am not diabetic till now, because I have tried to practice to a great extent. Now, that's the point. Of course, you can have many other evidences of that sort, and that's one of the important issues. Right, next part. Mentioned by our samhitas. Samhitas say, like, it's exactly the same reasons. Asyasukam, Swapnasukam, Vadhini, Gramya Anuta, Udakarasaha, Payansi. Any of those food substances which can produce the accumulation of the energy, or that accumulation of the energy, or calories is accumulated. I always compare to black money. When you earn more than what you need, you have to keep that money in reserve. So instead of paying the tax, you try to conceal it. So one day, that black money itself would be a burden, and diabetes is exactly the same. When you have more of the calories in your body, which is not given out to others, and which is not really given the proper share as such, that results in the diabetes. So diabetes is black money, and as the black money is increasing, diabetes is increasing. That's also the other part. And That's one of the important issue. And it's not only the medical treatment which is our target. There is a need to have convey this message to extent, to certain extent. I don't think that this message would be very attractive. I don't think that everyone would follow your message immediately. But we have to do our job. Like, there is one issue. And maybe those who follow may be benefited. If you do not follow, that's all right. That's about the point. Right. So that's about something away from the basic issue as I explained. Now, coming back to the primary issue. Primary issue is about our legal consideration and the management. So sorry if you have felt that I have gone away, but I thought I should focus on this issue and make you aware of that. Now, coming back to the diabetic patients as such, when you come to the clinics as such, in the present day situation, to articulate that whole complex clinical phenomena of the diabetes as we see, as I have experienced in my clinical practice, I found it difficult. I couldn't really make out how to present this issue. So at the end, I thought, I will be classifying the patients as I have seen variety of the patients and my strategies. These strategies would be according to the patient. And of course, whatever that percentage I have given, like 5%, 25%, that's just rough estimate, may not be very accurate. And that distribution of the patients whom you see in the clinical practice would vary from a physician to a physician, because all that patients coming to you would be depending upon the perception of the society. Some physicians may be perceived as a specialist for diabetes and pattern of the cases may be of different. But what I have found in my practice is majority of the patients of diabetes, they come in that category where the patients are having some treatment earlier. Say diabetes is stabilized or where diabetes is unstable, but they come to you for other disease conditions, may not be directly for the diabetes treatment. But you cannot neglect diabetes. That's one. Those patients who come for primarily the treatment of diabetes are comparatively lesser. Many of the patients whom I diagnose as diabetes for the first time, they are comparatively lesser, just about 5%. Patients coming with the diabetic complications, particularly diabetic ulcers and gangrenes, that's another major category which we have. Whereas acute complication like ketoacidosis, that distribution is comparatively lesser. This is how I get the cases. Now, that pattern may be different for different practitioners. That's as I said, it could be depending upon the perception of the society about your issues. Now, my strategies and my approach to the treatment in these categories, next slide. The first category, when I diagnose the patients of diabetes. Now, to diagnose the diabetes patients, you have the classical clinical signs which are mentioned in the textbook, polyuria, polyphagia, polydipsia, which you have learned by heart so many times. But beyond that, there are many other stigmata. There are many other classic stigmata which can help you to make the diagnosis of diabetes at an early stage, even before there are classical signs. And among those stigmata, quite important are the infections in the genital area, balanitis or vaginitis, brachial neuralgia, frozen shoulder condition. I make it a rule, a patient coming to with the clinical symptoms of frozen shoulder or the balanitis, as a rule, get the blood sugar profile and more than 70% would be diabetic. Interestingly, Savile's medicine, older textbooks had included this as stigmata, but the recent edition, that's removed. I don't know why they have removed, but incidence is quite important. So now at present, I am quoting this outside the textbook, beyond the text. Text doesn't mention about that. But that's one of the important issues. Whenever you come across a patient with a frozen shoulder or the balanitis, the first thing is you get the sugar profile and there is a high chance that you may have identified diabetes patients. And identifying diabetes patients is an advantage for both patient as well as you. Now, the other part. Then the other common, other stigma, other signs which has to make you cautious about the possibility of the diabetes are either a patient coming with a symptom of numbness, particularly those who say that I cannot make out whether I have a chappal or not. Those who tend to forget the chappal at the temples, they are the ones who tend to have the diabetes quite frequently. And that's the other characteristic feature. It could be a sign of diabetic complication also. Or sleep disorders, sexual incompetence, another of the common signs. Sexual incompetence also could be, these are the important stigmata. Once you have these symptoms, whether the patient was identified, investigated earlier or not. You need to review, see whether the patient is diabetic or not. Now, once you have diagnosed the patient as diabetes, my approaches to the treatment are different. First of the thing, when you have casually diagnosed and there are no other critical complications, if it is not a critical complication, I would advise the patient to not to take any medicines, just advise about this diet and exercise. About the diet and exercise, again, I will discuss that at the end of that, what's the diet and what should be the thing, and then we will come back to that part. So at the present, it's about the diet and exercise for 1 month, and then after 1 month, again, review, see the blood sugar level, and then only when it is beyond the critical level, then only we will start the diabetes treatment. Otherwise, I would not start the diabetes treatment. With that, many of the patients are benefited. You may call them. And there are certain patients who say that I am on the borderline patient. My question is, which border? Wagha border or China border? So that borderline is another of the somewhat confusing issue. There is a very typical cutoff line. Cutoff line, again, suggested by different guidelines are different. American guidelines are different. WHO guidelines are different. So I have my own guideline. And my guideline is, when the fasting blood sugar is more than 160 and postprandial blood sugar is more than 200, then only I will consider, and when it's more than 2 readings, then only I will consider that patient as diabetes, unless there are other classical clinical signs. If the patient has other classical clinical evidences of the diabetes, or if there are any complications, even at a lower sugar level, I have to consider that as diabetes. So that depends upon how the clinical presentation occurs. So in such a condition, if there are no other clinical signs, I would consider that as that so-called borderline or impaired glucose. Now, WHO says the same, impaired glucose tolerance or impaired these fasting glucose levels. In that condition, keeping the patient under observation and with the diet and exercise for 1 month. Now, if the patient is still shown to be diabetic, my first prescription would be always Asanadi Chandraprabha Aragivartin. Again, considering the target about the Kapha Dosha and Medodhatu, and that's my first of the target. Virachana is a game changer. If the patient follows a Samsarjana Krama correctly, that's, I would recommend the Virachana only such patients who can be reliable about the following of the Samsarjana Krama. If the Samsarjana Krama is not followed, a diabetic patient may have more complications. Virachana can result in more complications. Patient may blame you if the patient is not following the Samsarjana Krama correctly. And for the Virachana, I would always prefer Panchatikta Gugul Grita for the Snehana than the other simple Grita. With that, you can see a significant relief in majority of the patients, and majority of the patients can be maintained as non-diabetics. They can be maintained, continue to have a non-diabetic. Now, that's what, of course, then the other controversy is about the HbA1c levels, whether HbA1c levels have to be considered as a criteria or not, and what's the cutoff limit. Again, I will not go into the controversy. There is always a change, and the latest is even 7.5 has to be considered as non-diabetic. So we will not go into the controversy part. But for me, if a patient has more than 8 HbA1c, I will consider them as a diabetes. Till then, I will try to manage with this Virachana or Asanadi Kashaya, Chandraprabha, Aarogyavardhini. And with that, that's about the basic management. Then whatever the other additional prescription would be, depending upon other additional clinical signs. Suppose if the patient has neuritis or underweight, I will give brahmanachikitsa like ashwagandha or ashwagandha rishta, ashwagandha churna or so on. Or if it is the balanitis, gandhakarasayana, considering as a kachu, the kachu treatment as a. Teniasis again is the same, gandhakarasayana plus lagushudhishikaravati. Again, kapha, vyadhi, kachu only. Or it could be the neuralgia like conditions where the patient has brachial neuralgia or frozen shoulder. It's ekandavira or vishamasti. The idea is, it's not about the primary treatment for the diabetes, it's about the other conditions which are present, which could be the additional treatment present over there. Stress being another of the factors. Many times the patient may identify the stress, many times the patient may not identify that as stress and say that everyone would be, and most of the stressful patients would say that I don't have any stress. Those who have identified the stress, they are safer, and those who say that I don't have any stress, usually would have more severe stress, and in that condition, one of the other supplements which I will give is either Saraswara Rishta or very severe Smithisagarasa occasionally. That's the strategy for the first group of the patients.